So, welcome to
Friday
of Ivy Film Festival. We've had a really awesome week so far, and we've got two more days left, so looking forward to it. This talk is really exciting because it's our first new media speaker ever. So we're really excited to have you here, and you'll hear more about the talk later. But after this, we'll be having our official selection screening and award ceremony at Avon tonight. So feel free to come by and support the student filmmakers. So happy to have you here. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Vivian. I'm another festival director. Thanks for being here. Like Anna said, it's festival week, so we have a bunch more events this weekend, including a festival party Saturday night, a screening of Evil Dead Rise Sunday night, Lana Wilson, a documentary filmmaker, is coming Sunday as well. We have a lot of exciting things going on, so please come on through. They're always free and open to the public. And we're also on the main green selling merch every day, 10 to 3:30. Come stop by and hang out. It's sunny. And we have a lot of cool stuff made by our branding team. So yeah, very, very pleased to have you here. So thanks for coming through.
Hi, everyone. I'm Maya. I'm the third festival director. Very, very happy to have you here today for our first new media talk, as Anna mentioned. I'd love to give a warm welcome to our moderator for today, Will. He is our new media coordinator, and he is incredible. He is studying English and computer science. He is a senior, and he's been working with his team all year long to review new media submissions, choose the official selection, as well as bring our first speaker for the new media department to the festival this year, Molly Soda. So without further ado, Will.
Hey everyone, thank you for coming. I'm so excited to introduce Molly, who will be speaking to us, and then we'll do a quick Q&A with her. Molly Soda is an artist based in Brooklyn, New York. Nearly all of her work lives online, as she uses a variety of social media platforms to host her work, allowing for the work to evolve and interact with the platforms themselves. Soda makes videos, installations, and web-based interactive works that touch on concepts around performing the self, memory, aspiration, and consumer culture. We're so happy to bring our first ever new media speaker, Molly, out to the stage.
Thanks for having me. Thank you for the intro. Beautiful. So the way that I do talks is I'm made up of a bunch of links, and I try not to do slide presentations because everything that I make is on the internet, so I figured we can surf together. But I wanted to start with this PDF that I made a long time ago to kind of explain something to someone, and I thought it was actually a nice way to introduce kind of who I am and what I do. So I'll read it out loud, but you can also read along. The first time I ever posted a photo that I took of myself online was in 2003. I don't remember the exact picture, but I remember it was taken on my dad's 1-megapixel camera and posted to my Zanga account. I was 14. It became a ritual. I would stand in my room trying on different pieces of jewelry, teasing my hair, and combining clothing I wasn't brave enough to wear out of the house and take pictures, angling the camera, hoping that it would be in frame, and then turning it back around to see if I'd gotten a good enough picture to post. I've been taking pictures of myself almost daily and posting them on the internet for more than half of my life. I've grown up watching myself being watched. I've studied my face. It has become conditioned over time, like the way my mouth forms a pout when I turn the phone on myself or when I look in the mirror. My self-surveillance ritual leaves me acutely aware of my body in its flattened 2D state. My selfie enters a sea of selfies and hashtag new profile pic images. It is both captivating and mundane. My 2D body floats across screens, is tapped on, scrolled past, downloaded, discarded. I'm a GIF, or a GIF, an MP4, a JPEG, infinitely reproducible. So, as Will said, my name is Molly Soda. I'm an artist based in Brooklyn. I haven't always lived in Brooklyn. And I'll just give a little bit of background on myself while we scroll my website a little bit. basically all of the work that I make is really interested in online platforms, performing the self online, online communities, especially more feminine or more girl spaces, and kind of what happens when we make our private lives public. I was born in San Juan, Puerto Rico. My family moved to Indiana, Bloomington, Indiana, which is a college town. My parents are both college professors, and I grew up there. And I think for me, there was always this sort of split happening with, you know, being Puerto Rican, but growing up in the Midwest and not knowing that many people like me. And I feel like I always say I kind of like grew up online. And it was just a place that I went at a really young age to like look for connection or look for other people. I mean, I think a lot of teens on the internet, especially around the time that I was doing it, were looking for some sort of community or connection. And then it kind of became my art practice later. It wasn't necessarily intended to be that way. So I started off, I traded in my physical diary for a digital diary at the age of 14, and started making, like blogging and using various blogging platforms to do so. I actually took the, before this talk, I took an attempt to try and gather all of my accounts on this Arena channel called Digital Crumbs and see what was sort of still out there. But one of the main places that I was really on as a teenager was LiveJournal. So we're gonna look at my LiveJournal really quick. In its state of decay at this point, because obviously these platforms change over time, right? So I think LiveJournal has moved hands, so now it's a Russian-owned platform. And every image at this point has been wiped. And it's like wholly unusable, right? So this is what happens, right, when you put your life on the internet at a young age and you think that these things aren't gonna like decay and disappear. And eventually they do. I mean, the internet in some ways is forever and in other ways it's not, right? And I'm always interested in that tension and that sort of like, kind of like letting go of control over, also like how the way that my work is read, I'm interested in that as well, but I'm interested in how the platforms themselves kind of shape the work. And you know, my LiveJournal isn't my work necessarily. Sometimes I'll go back and use things from that. It's been a long time since I've really used that. But all of these links, right, all of these things, all of these crumbs make up some sort of idea of who I am. They shape some body and some memory of myself. And I actually went to school for, I want to find my Flickr, if anyone's familiar with Flickr. I went to school for photography. So initially I wanted to be a photographer. I was, let's go like to the last page. I want to see what I was doing like in high school, right? So yeah, so here's some photography, right? Not to like dunk on myself, I think I did a good job, but I think you should be kind to yourself about what you do when you're younger, because it's kind of the most fun time. I'm like going on a tangent, but it's kind of the most fun time to be making art, because you're just like figuring out what you like to do, right? And you're just like seeing stuff and you're so inspired by it and you're like excited and you just want to do it yourself, right? And so initially I took a photography class at the college in my hometown, and I was not intending to pursue art at all, and I decided to go ahead and get a degree in photography. I went to NYU, I went to Tisch, and while I was in school, I was still blogging. I was still like very much online, and I was still taking photos, but I was like, I had never used Photoshop. I was strictly like a black and white photo, like making prints in a dark room, kind of girly. And then something happened where I started to learn about performance art, video art, web-based art. I took a web design class. This is what really like clicked for me. I took this web design class that was in the photo department, and it was for photography students to make like portfolio websites, right? And then the teacher taught us a little bit about some like nonlinear websites or just like net art or web-based work. And I was like, oh, you can make websites that like don't have a means to an end necessarily, that are just like vibes or like fun. And so that's what I started doing. I never made a portfolio website in the class. I would just like show up with like weird ass websites that were like nonlinear and freaky. And then I just started getting interested in all that. And I was like, well, it makes sense to sort of merge kind of what I've already been doing online with my art practice. Like I just had never conceived of that being a thing. And so that was sort of my approach halfway through school. So I stayed in my department, but I ended up just doing video work as my thesis. And that kind of leads me to to Tumblr. Sorry, I'm giving you my history right now, and then we'll get to some work. But I think these things are important to kind of... Oh, here we go. Beautiful. Okay. So I started my Tumblr account in 2009. This is also the first time I go by Molly Soto. So at the time, I'm Amalia Soto. That is my real name. It's interesting... Online, I chose to go by Molly Soto on Tumblr. I don't think it was super intentional. I think, you know, you make a username on a platform and sometimes you get, it's just, you might get known by it. So Molly Soto was never like, oh, she's like a persona that I'm embodying, right? I'm gonna like perform as Molly Soto and she's this other person necessarily. But I was also really interested in like, playing with my real name, Amalia Soto, and then I was interested in sort of like the MySpace scene queen of it all, and like those sorts of names, like, you know, not using your real name or, you know, a performance name, right? An alias, essentially. And so I started Molly Soto, and my Tumblr sort of like, I want to show you, I plugged my Tumblr into the Wayback Machine just to see what I could find, and so this is my Tumblr at like, in 2009. This is it in, what, 2010? A little bit more 2011. Let's go to 2012. And so what happened was I started on Tumblr and I was sort of just like, I don't know, posting on there a lot, very, very online, very active. And I started to kind of get a lot of attention. And I don't know, people were paying attention to me on Tumblr. It was a good time in some ways, it was a bad time in other ways, right? And there still is a feature on Tumblr. I still use Tumblr regularly. If we look at my current Tumblr in its current state, this, you know, I probably reblogged this 2 days ago, so I'm still on the platform. But there's a function on Tumblr that, if anyone is familiar with it, there's sort of like an inbox function, or like people can ask you questions, they can be anonymous or not. And so I was getting all these questions on Tumblr, and I was very overwhelmed by them, but I started to sort of collect them, and I was like, okay, I'm getting all these questions, I'm not really answering them, and you can kind of see them in, you know, some of these posts, you'll see the little ask things, right? Oh, I had a wish list at this time, cool. Anyway, there's no example here, but I started getting all these questions, and in 2012, I sat down and decided to read all of them in this piece called Inbox Full. And in this piece, I go through and read every single question in my Tumblr inbox, and I didn't know how long it was going to take. It ended up taking 10 hours. and so I'm just going to show like a couple clips just to get an idea of kind of what the vibe was, and I don't answer any of them. I'm just sort of just going through and reading them through various states of my day, just like giving them each this equal amount of attention, right? Uh-oh.
Any advertising or marketing firm, right? You have succeeded where most...
Everyone can produce sound horribly.
Which is appealing to the current youth demographic. Whose sense of aesthetics and style align with where culture is heading.
The level of fandom you reach is legitimate proof of that.
And our firm would acknowledge this. You could easily get a job in advertising. I promise you, someone with your level of insight is in high demand.
What store? Places have you gone $50 for making pictures?
I was always curious if you had done a BFA. Now I am, and all I can say is I knew it. I'm studying my BFA in Australia. Yay. Do you have a photography website? I think you're absolutely fab, and I'm glad we share the same first name. No, there is a lot that is right with them. You're honestly one of my favorite people on this website. Not only are you beautiful, but you seem sweet and really seem to care for your followers. So many people on here are losing the sense of fun that Tumblr is supposed to bring, and I've become downright horrid. But you seem just to brighten my dash. Thank you, dear. You are simply lovely.
Okay. Well, I'm going to show a little bit more about like a rapid fire one.
Is it? What flavor is your favorite? I love you, Molly. You look like Yolanda Visser. Is your hair natural? Show your feet. What kind of cigarettes do you smoke? I'm going to build a little house with a picket fence and paint the side of it with your face. And it'll be the next to the ocean and we can pick flowers and all day and party all night, happily ever after. What do you usually say when people call you weird? What are your favorite bands? Favorite masturbation technique? Molly, I beg. I find you completely pretty and funny and smart. Oh my god, please answer the question about the gifts. How you turn videos into gifts. You're the processing firm repulsive, OMFG. Please, God, please tell me, us, how you turn a video into a gift. Oh my god, I beg of you, Molly Soda. Molly Soda is a few of my favorite things. Jack Mason is sticking up for you.
Okay, I think that's good. If you want to watch it, it's online. It's called Inbox Full. If anyone, it's funny, in the comments, some people will be like, I watched all 10 hours, like I finally did it. I've never watched it back. I refuse to. And so this was actually also a really important video piece for me as an artist because it was the first, this was the first video piece that I sold. Which at the time when I graduated from college, I was like, it was not like, oh, I'm gonna be like an artist, like as a career. I was like, okay, I'm gonna go and I'm gonna move to Chicago and I'm gonna work retail. And I'm just gonna like hopefully figure out some creative job or something that I can do. And in 2013, I got approached by a curator and there was an auction happening at Phillips Auction House in New York that was deemed the first ever digital art auction. I don't know if that's true. But this person called me and was like, would you like to sell something for this? And suggested a video. And I was like, you can sell a video, like, I don't understand. And then, you know, I ended up selling a version of this piece. I actually re-recorded it a year later and did it all in one take. This one, I think, took maybe 2 or 3 takes because I had to go to bed at one point. It was maybe like a piece that, or like something that really made me realize that this was something that maybe had some value and was maybe feasible to do because I was just putting all this stuff out for free and I was just being very online for free. And I feel like that's a whole different discussion that we can talk about privately or at a different time. But yeah, it really was a meaningful work for me in a way. And then I want to talk about YouTube a little more generally because not only was I just like vibing on Tumblr, I was also kind of around the time that I started going as Molly Soda, I created or kind of revived my old YouTube account and started just dumping on there. So I have 451 videos on YouTube. I've been dumping videos onto YouTube since 2010. and they kind of range. So it's a lot of webcam video, some sort of vlog style videos, videos of me singing, dancing, eating, crying, giving advice, I don't know, kind of doing whatever, right? So there's just been a long history of me with YouTube. And initially when I started doing this, I was just taking really quick like webcam videos. I wish I could show you the oldest. For some reason, it doesn't let you do that anymore. But I was taking these really quick webcam videos of whatever and just posting one like every day. And not really with any sort of idea or purpose, just kind of experimenting. And I think the reason that I've always liked using YouTube is because I think that YouTube is a really interesting space because I think it like kind of blurs the lines of context. And I also really like that there are many access points on YouTube. So like, let's think of, let me show one video. So this is an eyeshadow tutorial I did. I'm gonna mute it because we don't really need to like, so I think what I like about YouTube so much is that when I post a video on YouTube, people aren't necessarily like knowing what my intention is or like what I'm doing. Some people might be like, oh yeah, that's Molly Soda, she's an artist, I follow her. And other people are like, well, I'm just looking up a blue eyeshadow tutorial, or I just like am interested in this thing, or like whatever. And I like that there are many access points and that the context gets a little bit blurry. So for example, with this video, this was just like something that I posted for fun. I wasn't really trying to like, I don't know, it wasn't like an art piece necessarily, but then I got so many comments that were just like really critical of the video. And then, like, let's see, 654 comments, right? And it's people being like, oh, she sucks at this, or like, she's really bad at eyeshadow, or like, oh no, she's sweet, she's like doing her thing, it's fine, whatever, right? Like, some people like attacking me, some people defending me. And what I ended up doing with this piece was I ended up showing it, this is the sort of the large scroll that's happening here. So I never really intended on this piece being something that I showed, but then once it was sort of existing on YouTube and took on a life of its own and the comments started like kind of adding context to the video or like reworking the piece in a sense. So like when I post a video on YouTube, it's not necessarily like a finished piece. Sometimes I'm just dumping some stuff on there and maybe nothing will happen from it. Maybe there'll be an interesting comment that then gets printed on like a balloon, for example, or like used in a zine or used somewhere else, right? But for the most part, like I'm really interested in the video, like with the kind of things that are existing around it, like the suggested videos, the comments, everything that is sort of in contextualizing it, right? And it's always changing, right? Like I showed you that live journal, but it's always evolving and changing. Like you, that video when it was posted to YouTube in what, like 2017, looked different than how it looks now, and also looks different on your YouTube account versus my YouTube account, right? Like there's all these factors, and I'm interested in all of that, and also interested in the impossibility of never being able to capture that. So this scroll is like a period in time of whenever I was able to show this. This is in 2018. So I just wanted to show kind of like how my work can exist in physical form as well. Like I do think it's really important that my work be accessible online, and I'm really interested in that stuff always being available to people, and I'm really interested in using these platforms and the way that they shape the work. But I also think that there are ways to physically show the work as well that kind of add context to it as well, or just like maybe group it in a certain way. So I'm just gonna show a few physical installation shots. So this is an example of like me using some comments. This is a YouTube book that I did a while ago. I also love to show things on like phones, iPads, what have you. This is an example of sort of like a physical work that was incorporated DMs that I was getting on Instagram. So like no one is safe. Sometimes people get mad about that, but I'm also like, I don't know, you're like sending me shit. Like it's also, I don't know, it just feels like it's fair game, right? And then I want to talk about like a few pieces as well, so that you get a little bit more context for like what I'm doing. I mean, I've worked across a lot of platforms and a lot of modes, but I would say that I do a lot of video work predominantly. I really enjoy using webcams. I enjoy using kind of like the things that people are using on these platforms. So like, you know, I have a vlogging camera. I'm interested in being in within that language because this is what I consume, and these are also the communities that I'm a part of. And I think if I want to make work about that, I need to be existing within those communities and not just like an outsider being critical of that, because I'm like, I'm also these people, if that makes sense. Anyway, so this is a piece that is kind of a long, ongoing piece. I make a video for this every year. I'm just gonna show it to you. There's gonna be a lot of feedback, and then I'll explain it. I've been doing this piece every year since 2013, and initially, I have a playlist, we can look at it. So this is the original video, right? We'll make her a little quiet. And I made this video in 2013 in my bedroom, because I was, who knows how I was feeling. I think I was feeling a little sad, right? I'm listening to Death Cab for Cutie, you know, I'm like, I'm feeling sad. And this is normal for me to make a webcam video and post it on YouTube. And eventually, I started to build up upon it. And I would record myself over the previous video singing along to that video. And then it just became this practice that I started doing every single year. And, you know, it wasn't really about like the specific first video or the song or really anything, but it then became this practice of me sort of like mimicking and re-performing that initial performance and always sort of reacting to like what she was doing before, or like taking the Molly from the previous year and mimicking that, or like, so I'm so far removed from it now that it's like, I don't know what I was sad about. I'm sort of pouting a little bit. I'm trying to get there, but it's not the same. And also the feedback starts to come in where like the further, the more you layer this or the more that you re-record it, it's giving you that really crunchy feedback. So eventually it's just going to be unlistenable, right? So I need to record mine for this year, but I think I'll wait a few more months, but wanted to show that. And also just thinking about archives and the desktop as space, and it's so beautiful to see these older iterations of YouTube and like my desktop, and it becomes this diary, right? Like it's this performed diary in a way, because the more I do it, the more I'm also like reacting to my old self and performing that old self, but I'm also showing you like, maybe I, you know, this one I cleaned my desktop, and maybe the older ones I didn't, or something like that. And I'm interested in all these things kind of playing together. I'm also just interested in the desktop as space. Like, there's something really thrilling. I cleaned my desktop before this, so I feel like I'm cheating, but there's something really thrilling to me about seeing someone else's desktop, especially like during a talk, because I feel like you get a glimpse into like this inner world that no one gets to see. The desktop is also a space that's really not like publicized. Like at this point, we are so used to making everything online public that, let's see if I can find a piece. That everything is mediated, right? And the desktop feels like this space that just isn't very mediated. So like initially when we were when I was posting on YouTube at like a younger age, or when people, let's say the greater internet user was posting on YouTube, you would maybe just see them in their bedroom in its natural state. And then over time, as people are starting to make a living online or starting to post themselves online more, you start to see the same kind of sets happening. Like everyone's bedroom becomes this film set. Or people aren't even filming in bedrooms anymore, right? They're filming in like a special filming room, right? This is another thing. So it's like, I'm interested in these sorts of spaces. I'm gonna show like, okay, let's see if I can find this. I'm interested in also like the iconography of the bedroom as mediated by the internet. So like, what did it mean to have a fiddle leaf fig in your background in like 2019? Like, what are these things that are we're all starting to see, and everything starts to get like homogenized in this way? And so I did this piece called My Desktop Decor Relaxing, where I basically create one of these bedrooms, kind of like a prototypical YouTube bedroom set, but on my desktop. Let's see if I can get
to another video. Yes. In today's video, I'm going to be overhauling my desktop and my background space, and I'm going to really just be focusing on decorating it and making it a little more inviting and a little more fun. I don't really have a plan, so I'm just gonna wing it, and we'll see where it takes us, essentially.
Stock music is very important to me. I feel like everything has to be in the language of YouTube a little bit for me. I'm really interested in YouTube in general as a space and like the things that are happening on there. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit so you can see the room. All right, I'll leave it there. As everything is, it's all online, so if you want to look at it, it's there for you. But yeah, this is a kind of another way that I use the desktop. I think I want to show one more video, and then I think we can wrap it up. I have a lot of work because I just like to make stuff. So I think the last video I want to show, if we can get this going. So this piece is, well, let's just Google it. So this is a piece called Me Singing Stay by Rihanna, and I think I'll end it with this piece. And this is a piece that how I did this was I'm really interested in singing videos, obviously with the Death Cab video, you saw that a little bit, but I have a real affinity for girls singing in their rooms. And not so much like you trying to get famous from your beautiful singing voice, but that is good too. But I'm interested in sort of the impromptu singing video in the bedroom. You're so moved by this song that you need to share it. I think there's something really beautiful and earnest about singing. I think there's something cringy about it. I think that there's something very vulnerable about it. It's like how maybe your AOL instant message or away message was like a lyric. It's like the same impulse, right? And even thinking about early stages of TikTok when it was musically, it was always like, it was very much about performing to a song, right? So I've always been really interested in this. And it's been a thing on the internet for a long time. These singing videos, I think, aren't as common anymore. But basically, what I did for this piece was I collected all these videos of people singing alone in their rooms to the song Stay by Rihanna. The only reason I was particularly fixated on Stay by Rihanna was just because I really liked the song at the time, and so I was just like really into the song, and then I kept looking up people singing it, and then I made a playlist, and then I like curated from the playlist, and then I created a little choir. So we'll end it with this.
Thank you. let me know what songs you want to hear below. It's the most exciting thing on YouTube, so it's kind of exciting. Don't forget to follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and on Snapchat for all the lyrics. And I think that's it. Also, I really love you so much. Chops and positive. Bye, guys.
So glad we get to chat a little after. A lot I want to know. I will do a time for audience questions as well, but there's a few things that I also wanted to know.
Cool.
It was interesting. In the beginning, it struck me like a common refrain you hear is like, "I turn to the internet because like that's where I could find my community.
Yeah.
That's like where like people like me were." But how do you think your relationship to community and being on the internet has changed when you like gain this notoriety and like are a little bit more of like a figurehead of the community, where you have an inbox that's like 10 hours long?
Yeah, I think it's different. I mean, I think I was still able to find community on Tumblr though, because I was like friends with so many other Tumblr users who were like artists and who I now have collaborated with on like books and various projects. But yeah, it does get overwhelming. It also gets overwhelming to be like, yeah, I'm just like a girl that doesn't really know what the fuck she's doing, and now people are like asking me for like life advice or like expect certain things of me or whatever. And it's always been interesting. I think also it's been interesting being an artist and being so public online. Obviously I think it's worked in my favor, but at the same time it was always like this line. It was like, am I an influencer? Am I like I think for me on Tumblr, the tension for me was like, oh, I want to be a fine artist. Like, I want to be an artist, and people just think I'm like dress cool. You know what I mean? Now that doesn't matter to me. Now I'm like, that's interesting to me. And like, maybe that wasn't the right, I don't know, it doesn't matter. But it was like, it was an interesting time. I think I was still able to, I think my relationship to community was still strong. If anything, I felt like I had already sort of built a really good relationships online at an early age. And then I think Tumblr, I was able to just like spread that out a little bit more. And like now some of those people are like lifelong friends, which is all you can kind of hope for, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, or like find people that are making kind of, because you know, when I was in school for photography, for example, you know, maybe people weren't interested in the same stuff that I was making, but there were other artists around the world, around the country that were like making kind of like-minded or like making work like what I was making. So it was cool to find people like that.
Do you feel like your like relationship to the institution and getting more recognition from bigger things and selling stuff has like drawn you back to more interest in community and like being one of the many tiles in this, and like less in like being recognized by museums or whatever?
I think it's it changes all the time. I think that there was a point where I think initially when I started Tumblr, I was sort of just like, I'm just like figuring stuff out. Like, I don't think that I can have a career in this. And then when people started telling me that I could, I was like, oh, well, I got to worry about all this stuff now. And then now I feel like I'm at a better place with it now. But I mean, that stuff changes as you age too. I think when you're younger, you're way more free online, or at least I was. And then I've gotten older and I'm like, okay, well maybe I don't need to like, you know, I don't need to use it as like a public diary in the same way, or like I take a step back in different ways, or like I'm still within these communities, but maybe I'm looking at them from a different lens. Like, I'm not so in it in the same way.
100%.
Yeah.
Do you think the public diary thing, like with the being a public diary, like, do you ever feel like you regret anything you put up and you're like, I wish I didn't share that?
Of course. But I also, I won't delete anything.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you think that the internet archive, stuff like that, and like web links being broken, like is ephemerality and like maintaining like this almost archivist role of like older internet like important to your work?
It is important, but I also, it's a big undertaking. And like, it's sick that, you know, the Internet Archive has my Tumblr pretty well archived, right? But none of my YouTube videos are well archived. So, like, you know, they're still there, but, you know, I can't see what it looked like a while ago, right?
Yeah.
And it's not perfect either. And I think that's why I like the Internet, is because you kind of have to just accept that it's never going to be perfect.
Yeah, does that frustration with companies like Apple like invading such personal spaces like your desktop. Like ultimately they kind of choose what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Is that like something that is you think about a lot? Like this like in like because even with your talk, like you showed us the interfaces of what you're
mm-hmm.
working with.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like the unique like does that ingrain you with the community of everyone else who also is working across
yeah,
like, the same interfaces?
I think so. And I think it's like I think what I think about too is I'm always thinking about the future, for better or for worse, right? And like I think that what looks really mundane to me as an interface now, I'm going to really look back on in a few years or in like 10 years, I'll be like, whoa, like I'm yeah. so glad I have that weird death screenshot or whatever. Yeah. And so I'm interested in capturing this kind of mundane everyday stuff because I think we take it for granted, but it's like shaping who we are. Even just like the trends that are happening online. Like I think a lot of people are like, well, that's just like what girls are doing online, or like the, you know, the fact that we're all drinking out of Stanley cups or whatever, like, you know, pick, insert your thing here, right? Like, I'm interested in like the details of that stuff because I think that it there's like a thread between all of it.
Well, thank you so much for answering my questions.
Of course.
Are there any audience questions? Anyone wants to ask something? Yes, right there.
Hi.
So I've been thinking a lot about play on the internet recently. When I was in like, or younger, I guess, when I was a kid, I was so good. Anyway, I used to play a lot on these online world, like Moshi Monsters and like Club Penguin, mm-hmm. and they were really popular around the time, and then they died when Flash died.
Yes.
But recently, I found a very well-preserved rendition of Moshi Monsters, and it kind of unlocked this new way for a really long time. And in your practices, I feel like you're kind of finding ways not only to establish your identity on the internet, but also find ways to play and
yeah.
find cool stuff too. So I guess my question has two parts. The first is, did you ever also play these online worlds? And the second one is, how do you like to play on the internet?
Ooh, I love this question. Well, I recently, I used to do this like web series where I would surf the internet. It was like a live stream thing, and I did an episode on Flash because I tried to like look up all these old Flash games before Flash was about to die. And then that prompted me to get really into Neopets again, like in 2021, 2020, like really heavily into Neopets. So yes, I do play on those online worlds, and back then I was really into Neopets. I mean, that was my first introduction to being online. I ran like a guild. It was also the first website I made was a Neopets like offshoot website. Like my dad taught me how to make it when I was like 12. And so that was like really formative for me. And then I played on a couple of other ones. I think Club Penguin was a little after my time, but I also played one called like Maple Story, I want to say, and one called like Prison Tale. I don't know. Like it was just, those were more like actual video, like gamey, you know, like video gamey. But yeah, so that's my experience with that. And then also, I think playing online can be many things, but I think for me, playing is like, I think it's really important to surf. I don't think we surf ever. And so I love like, I feel like a broken record saying this, but like, so I don't want to talk about like this infinite scroll or whatever, but I do think that the way that websites are designed now is to keep you on them, right? Like they want you to, I mean, think about Instagram or TikTok or something. Everyone has a freaking link tree, which is so annoying. I will never use a link tree, but like, but they want you to keep on that website. You can't freely share links, really. And so for me, I'm always trying to like move outward and try and get lost, but it's really hard to get lost on the internet. Like you have to really take deliberate steps and really shape the way that you do. But once you're able to kind of do that, I think that that can be really healthy. So it's almost like, it's like taking a walk, for example. It's like something that you have to like be like, I'll feel better after I do this. Or like maybe I just want to like fall into a little rabbit hole online. But it is difficult. But that's what I try and do. Sometimes I'll even just like do walks on Google Maps or something. I'll like pick a place, you know, like that I vaguely remember from childhood and I'll like go walk there. So I don't know, that's one example, but there's many ways. Or like just like obsessively bookmarking stuff and then going back and like looking through old bookmarks and just like remembering stuff. I think there are ways to do that.
Cool. Any other questions?
My question is a little specific. It's about the me singing Stay by Rihanna video, which I just really felt really connected to because I also did that, but mine had a dance involved. But basically, yeah, that had me really thinking about that in like a very different way, so thank you for that. I want to know, in terms of that project, because you said you like curated the videos from a larger playlist, what like spoke to you in the videos that made you add them into the actual work? Like, was it like, I was just wondering while I was watching, like, were you struck by various backgrounds, like effects on the thing, like outfits? I just kind of wanted to hear your process.
I think a big part of the curation was the audio. So I was less interested in someone doing like a cover where they were playing maybe like guitar or piano, although I do have some piano ones, but more like karaoke style covers because I wanted to be able to, this for like a purely practical reason, but I wanted to sync them together like a little bit easier. And then also just interested in like someone in a non-professional space, because sometimes covers will have like the big microphone and like they'll be kind of really set up in a certain way. So I was also really interested in something that felt a little more off the cuff and something that felt like, yeah, just a little like non-professional, like I'm in my room. And then I think I only chose women for the most part. But that seemed natural to me as well. So yeah.
So your work makes me think a lot about the high femme expressions in like queer and lesbian spaces. And I'm wondering like, how are you exploring gender in your work? Yeah, are you like capturing the ultimate cyber girl?
I think the ultimate cyber girl is always changing. She can't be captured, right? It's like one, which is kind of messed up. But anyway, I think I am playing with gender in my work, obviously. I mean, I'm interested in like online girl spaces. I'm interested in all of that. And I'm also like, I'm thinking about that piece where I'm doing the blue eye shadow and everyone's really outraged. And a lot of people are like, she needs to like, you know, she needs to like wax her upper lip or like she needs to pluck her eyebrows. And so I was thinking about that piece a little bit, or like that video, and just being like, oh, like people are always getting mad when I'm like failing at like doing these sort of like feminine things. And like, I think I'm just doing a normal job. So I think also people just kind of tell on themselves in these interesting ways. So I think that's also a way that gender comes into play in my work. I mean, I think there's like a million examples of it.
Yeah, the sparkly shirt.
I'm Gene. I really loved all your pieces, and I'm not so familiar with the video work, but I seems like there's like a really interesting connection between like being like a curator as well as a creator in this space, and it seems like that's like for instant art that it has like a real inside love where you create almost like a spectacle of references. And I was just wondering like what your take on that like relationship, being like old with those people, and how if there's no more like artists that is on pedestal and he creates like their own universe. It's, so I was wondering if there's like future of that, or like how like that like dialogue works.
You mean on being both like a curator of your own work and the creator of your own work?
Yeah, I mean, because I'm like curating like a lot of like references.
Yeah. I think that can exist in many ways. And it is overwhelming sometimes, I think. I mean, I think it comes out in many ways. Like, obviously, I have to curate a little bit when I'm like, okay, I want to show physical work, and like, how am I going to make all these video, disparate video pieces like work together, but also thinking about curating like the imagery that I'm working with, or like the videos that I'm sourcing or whatever. I don't source too many videos. The Stay video is sort of an anomaly for me. I don't really use content that is not mine, for various reasons. And in a way, I do also use everyone else's content. Like, I use GIFs and I use like all sorts of stuff. So I don't know. I think that it is a sort of a difficult dance. And I think sometimes things are made easier for you if you set certain parameters, right? Like you're like, oh, I'm only gonna work with these things, or I'm only gonna, I had a friend, for example, she's making like these digital quilt things, and she's like, oh yeah, I set up like a software to like splice up the images for me or something like that. So also like creating these kind of parameters to do that. I don't make software, so I'm not doing that. But I think that is helpful. And I think also you kind of, I think when you're an artist, especially someone who's making a lot of stuff and like throwing it on the internet and kind of, you have to gather it up for people. You also have to talk about it, because people aren't going to necessarily find it. They might stumble upon it, and that's great, but sometimes you kind of have to make connections for people if you want people to sort of understand what you're doing or like the work that you're making as well.
Great. I think we have time for like one or two more questions. Yeah, right, with the flannel unbuttoned.
I was wondering how you see your work as, or whether you see your work interrogating the way certain online spaces or activities are based, since it kind of strikes me that your change of name from Amalia Soda to Molly Soda, like, is making a claim about how subjects are interpolated or shaped by a race.
By race? Yeah, I mean, I don't know that my work is necessarily fully touching on that. I think that I have my own, it's interesting that I go by Molly, you know, that I like flattened it in that way. I also grew up in the Midwest, and I'm really interested in like suburban girl culture, so I think it has to do with that as well. But I do think that the internet does have like a fully flattening effect on people. I don't know how much I can speak to like race fully.
Oh yeah, one last question. Right there in the dress.
I was just curious, I know you've had a lot of work about YouTube, but now like everything's so short, and I was curious like how your evolve, like whether you're gonna start making TikToks, you know, like as the internet evolves and like you're no longer like graphic.
I think about this constantly. I am on TikTok. It is humiliating in some ways, but that's not what it's all about. So, I think one, as a YouTube consumer, I'm very bummed because YouTube is dry right now. There's nothing I want to watch on YouTube. And two, as a creator or as an artist, I don't know. TikTok, I have been working with TikTok, but it's been interesting for me. I mean, when I started making work about YouTube, it was really hard for me to get in there. Like in 2013, when I discovered like beauty YouTube, for example, I was really interested in that, but I was like, I don't know how to make work about this. And so I was failing a lot. I was trying different things, and I was like, I'm gonna put on a wig and I'm gonna like do a haul video and I'm gonna be a character. And I was like, no, like that's too distanced. That's like not working. And then I started just making my own beauty videos. So I think this a similar approach with TikTok is like, you just have to start making stuff, and if it fails, it's fine. Will I make like solely short form TikTok content? Is that like where my work is going? Like not necessarily, but I'm on TikTok, I'm watching TikTok, I'm working with those things. Like I just did a video piece that I didn't show that was a video where I basically intentionally make my room messy, and I sort of reference TikTok, and I'm like, all the girlies on TikTok are showing like their dirty rooms, like this is like Sofia Coppola coded, whatever. And so I create this YouTube video where I'm sort of talking about that phenomenon and purposely making my room look messy. And so for me, the work is, I'm influenced by all of these things happening online within these spaces, and I'm making a little bit of TikTok content, but it might take shape in a different way, for example. And I did make a TikTok video that went with the YouTube video just to like, you know, have both. But it is hard, like kind of learning a new platform and putting yourself out there on those platforms. But also all this stuff takes time.
Great. Well, thank you so much. I want to thank you again for coming.
Thank you.
Quick plug, the official selection will be happening at the Avon right after this at 6:30, and the New Media Arcade will be in this building Saturday and Sunday from 12 to 6. But thank you again, Molly, for coming. We're so happy to have you.
Thank you.